Hi everyone, and hi Nivi, welcome on board.
Hi Sumit, thank you so much for having me for the session.
This is so amazing. So boys and girls, today we're going to be talking about all the things required for solo traveling. Let me just introduce myself and I'll introduce Nivi as well. So I've traveled 29 countries and primarily most of India, barring a couple of two states are only left. I'll talk about that. And Nivi has traveled. Nivi, where all you've traveled, by the way?
I've done most of Southeast Asian countries, so 11 countries, but I'm also going to second you saying I've done a lot more of India. I also have like 2-3 states pending, so we'll get to that part.
Lovely. So, bhai, aaj hum baat karenge solo traveling ke bare mein. I have been a solo traveler, matlab as itna solo loner ki I've done Maldives also solo. Can you beat it? Like it's a honeymoon destination. Have you done some awkward place like this, Nivi, where you're like, they're all honeymooners there?
Yeah, in India, I've done in Andaman, I've done 2-3 times, and there are very specific times when you feel like, "Arey yaar, why did you land up in a place where there are only couples?" But I think that's the beauty of
and
it.
They genuinely ask you, "Akele aaye ho? Matlab koi matlab mila nahi aur dost nahi aapka koi?" Then I give a story, "Nahi dost tha, aane wala tha," and you know, and sometimes girlfriend thi, aane wali thi, she couldn't make it.
I have told so when I did Sri Lanka coastal area, I've even told people that I'm married because I had to live up to certain expectations of the society. But yeah.
So amazing. So bhai, solo traveling, kitna paisa lagta hai, budget kya hota hai, planning kya hota hai, health factor kaise dhyan hai, aur travel kaise manage karna chahiye, and how you can do it in the least possible way. That's the agenda of the video. Nivi, why do you travel solo? Ya akele jaati kyun ho yaar tum log?
I do travel with friends, but solo travel is a very, very different feeling. I think it's a very fulfilling feeling. Once you travel solo, I think there is no looking back. You will not really wait for the company to go explore a place. So one of the reasons I travel solo is because I completely enjoy it. I sound a little narcissistic, but I do love my own company. So yeah.
And yeah, and for me, I think solo is not solo. You end up meeting more people when you're traveling.
Agree. Very true. I think what you said here is 100% true. Yeah.
And these people keep on changing. Like, aaj tum aisa bhi ho sakta hai, breakfast kisi ke saath kar rahe ho, lunch kisi ke saath kar rahe ho, dinner kisi ke saath kar rahe ho, and then later on you're not meeting these people as well. Lovely. So we got our own stories to tell. Whenever we're sharing this, hamare dimag mein, mere dimag mein Europe chal raha tha. We'll talk about that. Great. So number one thing is the most important: paisa, budget. So Nivi, how does a solo traveler plan their budget?
I think planning is a very, very important part, especially if you do have only a specific budget. Then I think I usually do. I work with Excel sheets where I segregate my budgets right from travel. As such, for flights, for food, for stay. So within my budget, I segregate these parts and I keep a miscellaneous part where you want to do certain impromptu things, right? So planning a place according to the budget you have is very important so that you can always find other options. Okay, this is the budget I have. How do I find a place that I can stay within this particular cost? This planning is essential so that you don't get caught up in the moment in the place, and you are also free to go out and explore. So great. This would be my suggestion. What about you?
Lovely. So I think for me, it's on similar lines, but sometimes I just tend to like splurge a little bit. Eiffel Tower pe chade hain, to Eiffel Tower mein, there are two variants, floor number one or floor number two, which is floor number two is slightly more expensive. Wo matlab 21 euros was the ticket and floor number one was around 14. So main fir soch leta hu yaar itni dur chal ke aaye hain, you've come all the way, so you should better take a 21 euro thingy. So then I splurge a little bit. Then I go off budget.
That kind of keeping it aside is, see, travel obviously will have a lot of impromptu things, right? Yeah. So having thoda sa extra budget is always good. But that said, having the basics sorted, I'm very sure that you would have stick to your budget when you choose a place to stay, or maybe you would have cut that cost during a transportation or taking by public means. So things like that, right? So finding that right balance is the key.
Right. See, the most expenses for me happens primarily on the stay and visiting these museums and touristic places. Number two and number three is food. I used to splurge a lot on the food, but dhire dhire maine wo kam kar
diya. That is number one. I used to spend a lot on food.
So I ended up leaving those 5 stars and, you know, getting that. Now I just go there for a coffee, just if the view is really amazing. Or you go and just have one Long Island iced tea and you sit there for hours and hours, and you spend about 20 euros or $20 and then you do that. But I now enjoy street food more than the normal food. So in $1 and even in New York, you can get a side burger if you guys want to, or a hot dog for that matter. So roz nahi kha sakte, but you get bored over a period of time. But I've ended up in Indonesia and Jakarta of the world and in China. So wo kafi amazing tha. So when you go on low budget, then resources automatically keep on coming out. But you cannot say like, hey, I'm going to have a €20 meal every day or $20 meal every day. So pehle fix karna chahiye.
I do have a question for you here. So since you have traveled across to both sides of the globe, be it east or west, for people wanting to start a budget trip abroad, which is the place that you would suggest? Which part of the world do you think is a good place for them to go on a solo budget trip?
So number one is Thailand. I mean, you go cheap, you go there and you spend 15,000-20,000 rupees and then you just boom boom and have fun. So Thailand is really amazing, and Sri Lanka is really cheap. Vietnam is really cheap. Cambodia is cheap. Laos is cheap. So before going to Europe, you'll burn your pocket for sure, because it's expensive. I was in Zurich last year. Zurich may the cheapest place is McDonald's for sure, but they've got the one of the most expensive McDonald's in the world, and you ended up paying like €20 for a typical chicken McMaharaja meal what you get in India.
My
the same
God.
Version of the same, yeah. And they've got a most expensive Starbucks as well. They got a most expensive Burger King as well. So McDonald's doesn't mean always it's cheap, but any which ways. So coming back, so picking up these Asian countries is good to start with, and then you can definitely do Europe. Europe, maybe you can do touristic destinations first. Start with France or Switzerland, Zurich. Flight is very cheap from Zurich to flight is really cheap from Paris to Delhi and Bombay. This is the most cheapest. And you get the easiest visa as well. I still remember last year, so on 25th, there was Christmas, and on 23rd evening, I decided I want to go to France, and and then I'll explore.
Oh, yeah? My God. How crazy you must be.
And I went to the visa center and I applied for the emergency visa, and within 24 to 48 hours, they've got a process, so you get it. And 26th morning, I was in the plane. So 24th, 23rd, I decided, and 26th, I was in the plane to France. And then once you reach there, you can actually do things. So France is the cheapest to start with to fly in. Great. So number one is your budget. Apna budget decide karo, pick up a country and do this. Number two is planning. So Nivi, you were speaking about an Excel sheet to maintain. So in this Excel sheet, they need to write on their expense, their daily expenses, what they're doing. Ki pehle hi itna mera Euro rail pe jayega.
Usually this sheet is for prior planning, where I know that this is the budget I have. Let's just say I have 30,000. I did Sri Lanka for 15 days under a budget of 35,000, including flights. So flights were good 11K from, I think I flew out from Chennai. So considering for 15 days, I spent only 25 grand, including everything. I did almost the entire part. I started from Colombo, went to Gandhi, Nuwara, did all the coastal places, and then came back. For something to see, again, I was not making much money back in the time when I did Sri Lanka. So I couldn't really, honestly speaking, I couldn't really afford an expensive trip. So when it comes to traveling on a tight budget, I think having a prior planning in terms of how much money you have and how much can you spend and how much additional you can have to splurge, all these calculations are essential. That's where usually my Excel sheet saves me. But that said, usually I map out places. I don't get into this intricate details of, okay, these are all the places. I don't do that, but at least I keep a rough plan when I travel outside the country, because you don't get all the time. You are on a particular timeline, right? Either 5 days or 10 days. So within that, I make certain decisions, saying, okay, 2 days I'll be here, 2 days I'll be in Kandi, maybe 3 days I'll spend at the beach. But usually I also don't stick to it, because when you are in the place, maybe you meet a couple of people and then you extend your stay. There was not even a plan to stay in a place called Haputtale. Plan was to go stay in a place called Ella, but I ended up in Haputtale for 4 nights, because the place was amazing. I stayed in a local host's place, and since there was a lot of local culture and interaction, I decided, okay, chalo, I'll just stay here, and from here I'll head out to the beach. So these kind of things do happen, but having at least a basic plan in place is essential, is what I feel.
Right. So write down everything, plus minus 2-3 days hota rehta hai. I personally feel our first day of the flight and the last day of the flight is decided. So even if you're planning in between, okay. So 3 days, 5 days, 3 days. So plan it accordingly. Check it out. Do your own research. Go to the various websites. I follow Lonely Planet as well, which is like my guidebook. I feel the travel is incomplete until and unless I'm not carrying that book with me. So that they'll tell you like a 5 days ka itinerary kaise hota hai. I normally cut it short to half, by the way. So I plan half a day to travel as well. I don't like subah uthe hain to agar Paris mein hai ya पीसा में है तो लीनिंग टावर ऑफ पीसा देखने जाना है तो सुबह 8 बजे यू गोना गेट इन द बस अलोंग विद ऑल दीस चाइनीज ट्रैवलर्स बिकॉज़ दे ट्रैवल अ लॉट एंड दे ट्रैवल इन ह्यूज ग्रुप्स एंड आई वुड सिट इन द बस एंड टेक अ ब्रेकफास्ट एंड आई डोंट डू दैट सो आई स्टार्ट माय डे लाइक अराउंड 11 o'clock डू अ हाफ डे काइंड ऑफ थिंग एंड रिलैक्स एंड नो रिग्रेट्स आई डोंट मिस आउट ऑन प्लेस आई डोंट हैव टू डू टच डाउन But if you're into good into planning, I think you can kill it. So point number three, which is a very important point while you travel, is openness. So Nivi, what is this openness? I know as a solo traveler, I mean, being a girl traveler as well, being in India and abroad, you'll be meeting new people. There'll be some kind of dangers associated with that. Have you come across something like that?
See, the point that you said at the starting of this conversation itself is the word, even if we travel solo, it is never solo. You always meet people. Some people are nice to hang out. And most of the time I stay in hostels because of the budget trip that I do. So obviously you will bump into a lot of people. Some people are really good to vibe with. Some people may not be. I usually go with my instincts. I've had I wouldn't say bad experiences, certain awkward experiences, but I think that's a part of travel. I don't take that one experience and judge everyone around. That said, most of my experiences with people have been good. I have partied in Philippines for an entire night. We were, I think, a group of 12 people all from the same hostel. Another reason also is because that was a group that I felt safe with. We were a bunch of girls and boys and they made sure we reached back the hostel safe. So when you know, when your instincts tell you that this is a safe group to hang out with, then go ahead and explore. Other which ways, being a solo female traveler, always have this cautious in your mind, even if it is for male. I think you will second this with me, because there are chances that people will get mugged. Anything can happen to you also. So in that case, I think going on with your instincts, knowing, okay, if you feel that, okay, this particular thing is not happening, then it's better to just stay in the hotel or stay in the hostel. So that's the safest way to go.
That's great. Even for the male travelers, trust me, I've had all kind of incidents in from New York to a Leaning Tower of Pisa. Just my phone was snatched away. I had an iPhone and, you know, somebody came and snatched it away. I mean, you'll have all these kind of awkward experiences. But openness to all these things. Yaar, tum ghar se bahar nikal rahe ho. Kuch to achha bura to hona hai. You know, you're not sitting in the comfort zone of your house. You know, you're always on the train. You'll be missing out on the train. Pair phislega, ye sab hoga. Chot bhi lag sakti. We'll talk about the health reason as well. But openness is really, really important. You go with the family as well, you know, you go with your friends as well. You're on a river, so pair phisal sakta. You'll be meeting awkward people as well. In India also, you know, you can be, as a girl traveler, I know a lot of my friends have been followed by people as well, right? So, bulky, I find Europe areas more safer for Indian women to travel than India. I don't know, maybe, what do you think on that?
See, I have not really ventured into the West. India is okay, as in, see, we are locals here, right? So at least we know certain things. We have our roots, we have our cautious flag always up. But for people outside us traveling in India, I think they have to be a bit more careful. But I think this thumb rule applies to any country. Anywhere you travel solo, you have to understand the surrounding, you have to understand its people. Take out, as you said, take it slow. You don't have to rush into it. Analyze if the surrounding is telling you that the shops close at 8 o'clock. If everybody goes to sleep at 9, then it is advisable for you to get back to your place of stay around 8, 8:30. Not to be out there at till 11.
I think humne inko bahut dara diya hai. We're talking about openness, be openness, but I think they're going to be getting afraid right now. Shit, aisa sab hota hai.
See, but that's the beauty of travel, right? I mean, whatever heads up that we give, there will always be a surprise element that is coming on your face. So that's the whole beauty of it, I think. You and me completely enjoy these experiences. So for people who are venturing also, I think you have to keep an open mind to these experiences. Right. You might want to stay safe, but whatever happens, you have to take it in the stride and then keep going.
True. So what I do, I normally do hostels. So whenever you do hostels, so there, you know, they're all kind of people. So I was doing Tomatina about 3 years back, La Tomatina in Spain. So I normally go 2 days in advance of the festivals, and so that if I'm with the hostel mate, there are 6 or 7 options. There are like 6 or 7 beds in the same hostel, so you can actually talk to them and see. Jiske saath vibe ho raha hai, yaar. It could be a girl or a guy, depending on jiske saath vibe ho raha. People have a very wrong conception towards hostel. How will I sleep with the how I'm going to be sleeping in the same room where there are like 6 more people? One could be Spanish guy, and how can I share bathrooms? Blah blah blah. You are a solo traveler. You are a budget traveler. Sharing a bathroom is not like sharing together in the same bathroom. वो यहाँ shower ले रहा है, वो shower लेके आएगा, उसके बाद ही तुम जाओगे. I mean, that's the basic common sense. Great.
See, so, for people who still are trying to figure it out, I think currently, even in India, there are a lot of hostels. Maybe when you and I started traveling, there might not have been options. Or even when I started, Zostel hardly had some 4 branches in the country. But right now, any city you pick, there is hostels. So for people, you can start it in even in India to get a hang of how these hostels work. You can even go to, I mean, you will be able to add a lot of pointers here. Himachal has a lot of kick-ass hostels where they can stay and explore. So start it in your home country, in your homeland. Once you're comfortable, then you will know how to handle it outside.
Right. I've ended up seeing hostels which are better and more cleaner than the normal places, actually. So which is, I mean, nice. In Europe as well as in Sri Lanka also, I've been in a hostel, and in Colombo, that was also pretty good. I've stayed in a hostel in Maldives. It is not a hostel, it is a guest house, but actually you can actually share the same apartment.
Maldives and a hostel, wow. Yeah. I really need to get talking to you to understand.
Life of a solo traveler, it's going to be happening to you. Moving in point number 4. The point number 4 here is really about the travel. So travel links up to the budget as well as the planning. But what's your take on that? How they should be saving some money and planning their travel?
I particularly think that taking or settling for a public transport, whichever that country has, gives you a lot of opportunity. It can also like bring down your budget very tight. I'll give an example here in terms of Andaman. To reach from Port Blair to any of the island, you have to take a ferry. So even there are 2 kinds of ferries. One is a government ferry, which is dirt cheap. Like it's hardly some 150, 200 bucks. This is majorly for the commute of the local people. So obviously the facilities are not much. It's just that you sit in the ferry, you go land yourself in the island. That's how it is. You can take another public ferry, which is around 1,500 to 2,000 rupees. Whereas there will be a bit more comfortable. Obviously there is AC and all of that, so you can get enjoy and go. But as a solo traveler, more than a solo, as a budget traveler, if I am on a tight budget, then I would just take a government ferry because it's just 2 hours. I'm going to be on the island. Whatever I want to see on the island is what matters to me. Sure. So this would be my tip. Another thing, even in an expensive country, see, I did Hong Kong on a very tight budget. Again, Hong Kong is said to be a country that's super expensive, but the subways there are so good. They are so well connected. I think I stayed in the other part of the country, whereas I had to go to the airport. All the connectivity happened only through subway. So if you're someone who is game to just walk around a little and take the public transportation, please do go for that option because you can save so much in that. So yeah,
you cannot afford a taxi in Hong Kong, by the way. So subway is the only way to go. Hong Kong is really
maybe that is also true, because otherwise also the country is so freaking expensive.
True that. And I remember the boat from Hong Kong City to the Lama and the Lantau Island was around 2 RMBs, around 2 Hong Kong dollars, which is around less than 20 rupees that time. So it was really, really cheap. And if you take a private boat, it's going to be really expensive, nearly around 20-30 Hong Kong dollars. Great. If you're traveling in from Delhi to Himachal, like I did a trip from Amritsar to Himachal, but rather than saving money and going by the bus, it was around 1500 rupees. We took a cab actually with a driver. It came out cheaper. So if there are more people, definitely this is a common sense, you know, 1500 rupees into 4 people, 6000 rupees, you can actually commute with the driver there and stay there also. So that came out very cheaper. So do your calculations and plan it accordingly. If you go to Europe, there is a bus called as Felix bus, which is like around 20 euros to travel from country to country. But if you're going to do a Euro rail, it's going to be a little bit faster, but you end up paying about 120 euros, which is really expensive. And there are very good apps for the same as well, where you can check it out, book your apps. It's pretty good. There are like bus points where you can add in. So you can save money a lot while traveling as well.
So when you spoke about the apps, I think it is applicable even in all the Southeast Asian countries. Wherever I have traveled, most of these people do have apps, even for your public transportation, right from buses. Korea, I had like a bus. The only thing is you have to spend some time before you travel or after you just land in the country to figure out what are the local apps that these guys use and download and keep, because the timings, right from bus schedule to everything, will be there. It makes life a lot more easier because the tech is right now very advanced, and making use of it is a very smart choice.
True that. This is so amazing. Yeah. So use the tech, download the apps of that particular country, read the books and check it out. What's the best possible app for that country? There are maps, there are offline maps also, which could be helpful for you when you're traveling in the same. Great. So number 5 is health. Now, this is the most ignored topic, health. Like, you know, I felt sick in Europe. I felt sick in Zurich as well. I wasted like 2-3 days sitting in Cambodia, and you know, because I traveled too much, I was doing that Angkor Wat temples, and those are like a 3 days trip, and it was scorching hot, and we took our bicycles there, and we were actually doing the whole thing, and I wasted my 2 days because I got sick because of exertion as well. What's your tips on health, Nivi?
This again, as you said, I've also learned this lesson only because of experience, and it happened very much in India when I did a trip very early in my during my early days, where I went on a trip to Manali, came back, felt sick because of climate conditions, and I wasn't even able to find out medical shops because we were on the road. So I had to come back to Chandigarh or Delhi to even pick up my basic medicines. After that, this is a thumb rule that I have followed, whether it is a weekend trip, 1 week trip outside the country, within the country. Please do carry a first aid kit that has certain elements there in place, right from your bandages, cotton, your paracetamol, Disprin, certain basic medicines that you know will work for your system. Please carry it with you. There have been times where it has not been useful to me, where I have helped other hostel people who had fallen sick. So you never know where it will come handy. But this is a definite thing that I would suggest everyone to follow.
Right. So amazing. So getting sick just before the event is more scaring. I'll talk about La Tomatina. You've seen this Zindagi Na Bhi Lage.
Are you have to tell me about the festival also. I've only seen it in the movie. And considering you have witnessed this, I would like you to share a couple of words.
It's so amazing. But I tell this to all people. Don't get sick just before that. So I was sick one day before, evening before the festival. And you're so excited. You go to Spain just to do that. And then you are sick. So because you ate some wrong food or you overdrank as well. So if the food is cheap in Asian countries or in European countries, if you're trying something new, take care of your health as well, and take care of your daily meditation and yoga stuff if possible, if you're into working out a little bit. But Nivi was suggesting me, you were telling me like before my last trip, like if you are into workout, then you can choose some of the activities which are going to be like a workout kind of thing.
So see, I'll tell you what I do. Okay, I'm not a person who is into gym or gymming, but I do yoga at home on a very regular basis. I also did my yoga instructor course. So that for me was a vent out. But there will be places, there will be times where you will not get time to spend into, like, set aside half an hour from your calendar, from your schedule to work out in your hotel room or hostel for that matter. In cases like this, what I would suggest is try adding certain fun activities. See, you can pick up a walking tour in the country. You can go for a morning jog where, see, the entire city is also silent. It will give you a very different vibe where you even go for a jog for 2 kilometers and come back. It is like an exploring a new place, right? If you are in a beach destination, then I would suggest go for a swim. Indulge yourself in certain water sports. See, try adding a bit of sports into the plan. It doesn't have to be extreme adventure, but even these kind of sports will still keep you fit, because obviously the kind of food that we are going to intake during the period of travel is going to be insane. So somewhere I think we have to find a balance.
Great. I have a rule on this. So I should never miss a sunrise or a sunset in that place. So this is the thumb rule which I follow wherever I go. Sunrise in some places like Kanyakumari can go up to like 4 a.m. in the morning. Then I actually go by 6. That's perfectly fine. But I tend to get up in the morning and see the sun coming up over the mountains.
God, you are an inspiration. I am a completely non-morning person. So the only thumb rule for me is sunsets. Sunrise, I've had some really good sunrises, but they can be like hand counted. Even in a place for me, it gets really difficult to wake up in the morning. So how do you maintain that? Do you, even if you are traveling, do you go to bed early? How do you keep? Because this
my body clock,
like, I don't even sometimes get to sleep because I'll be so excited in another country.
My body clock is really amazing. If I drink too much, then also I wake up early. If I drink less, definitely I sleep early, so I wake up early. But sunrise, one thing, when your fellow mates are sleeping, your hostel mates are sleeping, as you said, it's rightly quiet. You go out, you find some dogs, and you see some really, really good local life there, you know. Yeah. People are cooking food, going to school. We were in Shimla, in fact, last month only. So people are going to the school, and you know, you can relate with them. Array, when I was a kid, when I was doing that. So you live back the memory line, and they're all dressed up in suited, coated. Then you're able to see, oh, it's a colonial population in here, and they still have formally dressed schooling rather than other parts of the country. Most of the schools are formal, but you could see like the British impact to the same as well. This is so amazing, yeah. So we've done five quick tips about the entire solo traveling. So we've traveled together about 40 countries, 29 plus 11. And I think this video is helpful. Nivi, any parting thoughts to all these great people who are listening to us?
I do have a question for you on a personal note. Considering that you run your own company, tell me, how do you balance work and travel, considering you have the entire responsibility on your shoulder? Like, how do you keep aside? How do you come up with your travel plans?
We will do a separate video on, you know, how to take your time out and how you can manage both the things. And quick tip is, if you're going to US, so don't take an American Airlines, don't take an Indian Airlines, take a Sri Lankan Airlines, or you take an Egyptian Airlines. If you take an Egyptian Airlines, then if the stopover in Egypt is more than 24 hours, then you get a free stay in Egypt as well. So you can go into the pyramids.
Smart.
Yeah. Yeah, so you can always travel, and you can, these all details mostly are research based. And I was in UK, so you can do a Sri Lankan visa. Go to Sri Lanka first, and then go to UK, stay free stay of Sri Lanka in a 5-star Jetstar property in Colombo. That helps you to get one more country ticked on the way as well. You don't explore the whole country, but that's a good way to actually
do
the Egyptian stuff.
Good. I think this is a good pointer. Maybe we will discuss in detail about it in the coming sessions.
All right. So thank you so much for listening by. I hope you guys have enjoyed the video. If yes, Nivi, ask them to like the button here and press on the subscribe button as well.
Of course. Hope you guys have found this session useful. We will be also coming up with more such sessions. So if you find it useful, please hit the like button and subscribe.
All right. Thank you so much for joining in. All the best, guys. Stay safe wherever you are, and do travel as long as things open up. We're also planning to travel soon together, and we'll have a lot of fun. Thank you everyone for joining in. Bye-bye. Bye, Nivi. Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye.